I have insurance, and so I don't need to focus on anything else other than just my physical well-being, because a bike is completely replaceable. And the fact that you have insurance and that you're protected and you're covered, all you need to do is focus on yourself and getting yourself better. Like, I'm going to try and I'm going to take risks and I'm going to take chances, because why else? Why would you not, right? I'm Alicia Speak. I'm 37. I'm a full-time lawyer, but I'm also a cyclist for Cycle Team London.
It's been a wonderful 3 days. We're coming towards the end of the Rouleur Classic, but we've got some wonderful guests to introduce and to talk to you and to share stories with. And our next guest is a living legend. I'm just going to say who it is, because the rest kind of speaks for itself. That's why you're here. You're here to listen to him. It is Mr. Johan Museeuw, the Lion of Flanders.
First of all, bam.
Yeah, is that? I hope mine's turned off. But you got the new one. You got the new one.
Yeah, it's a new one.
Yeah, have you played with the photos?
My other one was 3 years old, and I say it was time to get a new one.
There we go.
The problem is I don't have so much money as I was a rider.
Oh, right. Okay, so you've got to pace yourself.
Yeah.
Okay. We were chatting sartorial. We were chatting about kind of menswear earlier on. He did have a similar jacket on, but have you noticed this? Do you remember the World Cup? It was like the leader, it was like the UC, it wasn't like the UCI thing, it was like the world, it's called
it's,
the World
it's
Cup.
It's still in cyclocross.
Yeah.
But it's also another jersey. So, but that's the reason that I don't wear a jacket. And I have a special jacket.
You do have a very
I
special
I buy it 2 days before the World Championships, also in UK. It was raining, it was bad weather, it was Flandrian weather. It was cold. So I say I will buy a new jacket. But with these colors, I have to be like this. Yeah. But you have a nice jacket.
Thanks, mate. Yeah. Thanks, mate. Anyway, there we go. We've kind of stoked each other's kind of sartorial egos enough. But we know your kind of record speaks for itself. Obviously, the classics. But this year's Rouleur Classic is talking about... We will talk about the classics, of course. But this year's Rouleur Classic is a celebration of the Grand Tours. And when you look, when people immediately think of Johan Museeuw, they think of you as a Lion of Flanders, 3 times Paris-Roubaix, 3 times Tour of Flanders, world champion. They think of you as a classic specialist. They think of your comeback from injury and winning Roubaix again after nearly losing your leg. But also, the Grand Tours, especially the Tour de France, has been a very important part of your career. And we were talking yesterday before Greg LeMond came on stage that as a young professional, you rode on the ADR team with Greg LeMond.
I was 21 years old.
Yeah, in 1980, so you rode the tour that
much
Greg
younger,
won.
Much nicer. Much but my English was not okay.
Okay.
Yeah, you are young and you can do the Tour de France. And I was in a small team, ADR. There's a jersey over there, the Santini.
Yeah.
I have signed it yesterday. And yeah, José de Cor was my sport director. And I did it quite good as a young boy. I was not a winner, but I was second, third, fourth, okay, quite good. And he say, you have to go to the Tour de France. I say, José, I'm too young to go to the Tour de France because I will burn me, I will kill me.
Yeah.
No, you have to go to the Tour de France, and then afterwards you will become a big rider because your engine now, this is the engine of a rider. It's too small for this moment, and you have to do 3 weeks a Grand Tour, and then your engine will be much bigger.
And he was right, wasn't he?
Yes, yes, yes. But first of all, you have to do the Tour de France with Greg LeMond. Eddie Plankard was also there as a sprinter. But I know some 2 days were very special for me. That year, because Greg LeMond was coming back from his accident, and he was not really a favorite, but he was still Greg LeMond, big hero, champion, tour winner. But there was Laurent Fignon, a French guy, and I remember the day it was the attempt to Marseille, and it was crosswind that day. And I say to myself, even when I was young and not so smart, but I say, I have to be in the front of the, at the start. Yeah. And we go immediately, and Fignon and Laurent and Motet was going away. Okay. Bam, immediately. And they take 2 minutes, and behind we are with a small group with 20 riders, with also Greg Cremont, and the whole PDM formation. Kelly, Rogues, Breuking, all that legends. And José de Cowell was coming to me and from in his car. And it was not electric, it was like that.
What a lovely little bit of detail. I love the detail. So you're like, hurry up.
It was 2 minutes, the breakaway, Fignon and Motet. And he said to me, can you close the gap? I was looking to him, I say, José.
But you, like, got on the front, closing
you
the gap.
Know who is in the breakaway? Fignon,
two of
Motet.
The best time trialists in the world at the time.
Amazing, riders. Yeah. Go. And I have chasing about 60K kilometers. I don't know exactly what it is in miles.
40 miles, roughly. Yeah. Yeah.
And yeah, finally, we are clothing the breakaway. Yeah, and then there was somebody who's chasing also. And I tried to be again in the breakaway. And José de Cowell come back to me again. And he say to me, you have to stay with your leader, Greg Cremont. But the guy won the etape. And after, if I was calling home, not with my mobile phone, because it wasn't yet a mobile phone. It was in the hotel, and it was a big phone, and you have to ask an outside line again. And yet, sometimes you have to wait a couple minutes or 1 hour, because if you're with...
And you have to queue to get for a phone back here, yeah.
If I was calling to my daddy, he say, what a stupid guy you are. You can win the etap. I say, yes, I have to stay with my...
with your leader.
With my leader. But anyway, going on. Let Greg Cremont take the yellow jersey, chasing. But finally, the last day, LeMond was second in the classifications between Greg Cremont. And I have already looked in the map, already how much money we will receive, because I was young.
You looked at the prize list to kind of make sure.
I made the count. Yeah. It was okay.
Yep.
for the second place.
Oh, for the second place.
Yeah, he was second in the classification.
He had to make up like 40 seconds or something, didn't he? 50 seconds he had to make up, didn't he?
And then the last day, it was a time trial at the Champs-Élysées. Special for the Champs-Élysées. Normally, it's a sprint.
Yeah, starting in Versailles.
That I won also.
Of course.
At the Champs-Élysées, as a sprint.
1990, yeah.
But I was far behind in the classification. I have done already my time trial. I was in the hotel. I come in, I put on the television, and I heard, quel suspense, Laurent Fignon, LeMond. I said, well, what's happened? And finally, Greg Cremont was taking the yellow jersey the last day.
And eight seconds,
it was special for us because we arrived with three teammates in Rouen.
Wow.
So the money was okay for three. Yeah. And in the evening, we were inviting in the Moulin Rouge all together.
Okay.
So then I was young.
Yeah.
It was all new for me.
I'd imagine it was an interesting
beautiful
night.
Girls, Champs-Élysées, it was all new for me.
Okay, so it was a wonderful experience.
So that was my first Tour de France.
Wow.
Yeah.
That's amazing.
Yeah.
That is, because I kind of, know about you, but that I really didn't know that until yesterday, and that's an amazing story. But that must have, you must have learned so much.
Yeah, and Greg Cremont was saying to me, okay, now you can follow me for criteriums, and we can do a couple of criteriums together.
Of course, yeah.
Because you have worked a lot for me, and I said, yes, okay, why not? And I did 15 criteriums together
15.
With him.
15?
Yeah, one day in Bordeaux, the other day in Belgium, the other day over there, and... Yeah, it was quite busy.
It was good.
But it was okay for me.
And what about your thoughts on Greg? I mean, he's a lovely guy, isn't he? He seems like an honourable gentleman. you know.
He is American, and that's also a little bit different for if you come in European cycling.
Yeah, especially if your English isn't sort of perfect like it is now.
So and then I was also quiet, silence.
Yeah.
I don't want to speak to nobody. I was already afraid to speak with you or with everybody. Now it's totally different.
Of course.
He said to me, and that I don't forget anyway, you win the Tour de France in your bed. So, and why? I say always to him, because he didn't go as dinner. He didn't come to eat with us. He ate in his room. He did the massage in his room. Everything he did in his room. Because he say, 3 weeks, if I go every time down to eat, 3 weeks, that's a couple hours.
It adds up, just collect. Yeah. Sean Kelly is the same. He said that the Grand Tour is one in your bed.
Yeah.
And it's you need to be able
then
to recover.
Then I remember that he said to me when I was young, you win the Tour de France in bed. But I didn't win the Tour de France.
you walked up too many stairs. That's what it was. But then moving on to the following year, 1990, Le Monde won the Tour again, but you're in a different team. And you got your first stage win.
Yeah.
And then your second stage.
As a young boy, Tour de France is something big and you want to be there. And it's special. It's the biggest race in the world. Yeah. You have to say that.
Yeah,
it's the biggest race. You have a dream to win some stage in the Tour de France or to do something good in the Tour de France, because you know there is always television and the family was looking to you and you say you want to be in the front and television.
It's what you dream of when you want to turn professional is the Tour, isn't it?
Yeah, then you win a stage.
Describe the stage for us. I mean, a lot of people here wouldn't have seen it. I would imagine quite a few did, but
It was a quite windy day.
Okay.
And it was really fast. It's always fast in the Tour de France.
Yeah.
If the tour director say, yes, you can go, bam,
bam,
they go. And they go every day. And after a couple of days, you don't believe that they go every day like that. And I hope someday, today, they don't go.
No.
And again, and again, and again, and again. So, that's the Tour de France. There is so much publicity in the Tour de France, and everybody wants to take some publicity. But it was an etap of 235K, quite windy, quite hilly, and at the end we have a lot of crosswinds. But finally, I was always there in the front, and everything was coming together the last 5K, and we go to a sprint. And I have won already some sprints, but I was not thinking that I was a sprinter.
Okay.
And I won the sprint between Olaf Ludwig. So he was...
He's running for Panasonic then?
Panasonic,
Ludwig. Yeah.
Big rider, a sprinter.
Powerful rider.
Power man.
Yeah.
So I was winning that stage. So for me, that was really something special.
Did you have... I mean, that was quite early before we saw proper lead-out trains. I mean, the proper lead-out trains
not exactly, because we didn't have lead-out trains. That's a little bit changed the last years. A sprinter has a whole team around him.
So were you looking after yourself for that sprint?
Yeah, I have to.
Did you have one guy with you, or was it just you?
Just me alone.
Wow. Okay.
So how did you... I can go around everywhere in the peloton, just like that. And what's the reason of that? Because I was, as a young boy, I was a cyclocross man.
Okay.
And I still see the same things as you do as a young boy. Cyclocross, you can move a little bit more better.
We can see
between
it now with the riders that are coming through.
Yeah.
Good riders, you know.
Sagan was cyclocross man.
Yeah. Van der Poel.
Van der Poel.
Yeah.
Van Aert.
Yeah.
So, I was alone. And finally, I won the sprint. And that was the entry for me to be a sprinter. And before I was thinking, I was a climber.
Right.
Yeah.
Because from a climber that wasn't a climber.
The Kemmelberg, I was going up the Koppenberg, and nobody can follow me. And but I didn't saw a hill.
You didn't see the Alps. You didn't see the Pyrenees.
The first hill that I saw, it was with the national team as an amateur, and it was in Austria, the Grosslochner.
Okay.
2,300 and like that. Altitude. And I say, today I go, eh? Because I'm a climber.
Okay. Full gas from the bottom.
I was, yeah, I think I was 1.5 hours behind. And I know I wasn't the climber. But 2 days later, I was winning a sprint. So,
then you realize.
As a young rider, you have to see what you can do.
Of course you do, of course you do.
And to be honest, after 10 days in the Tour de France, physique, I was empty.
Yeah.
That was the reason. I can do 10 days good in the mountains as well one day.
Yeah.
But after 10 days, it was over.
Okay.
The heart was not higher than 140. It was staying like that.
Yeah.
I was tired here and all physical way.
Yeah.
But I was still there in the Tour de France. And yeah, the team wants that you stay there. But I think it's better you go home if the engine or if you don't have fuel anymore.
Yeah. But you
have to go home.
You carried on though. You carried on. The Champs-Élysées. You won on the Champs-Élysées.
Yeah, but you know, I stay always because I have to defend the World Cup after. Because 1 week later, we have already San Sebastian.
Yep.
And we have Zurich. It does not yet anymore. So yeah, we were thinking because we don't have pole meters. Now they have pole meters. They can see everything.
Yeah.
We don't have trainers. Eh? We have to do it all by ourselves.
Just from feel.
And they say you have to do the Tour de France because after you have to be in a good shape and good condition. No, it's totally different.
Yeah.
Totally different.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
But anyway, I did 11 times Tour de France.
Yeah.
Yeah. And then I have good memories and bad memories.
The good memories must be 1994 when the race started in the UK for the first time since Eddie Merckx rode in 1974 when it started in Plymouth. So it started in the south of England. It was when we were just talking before when the Euro Tunnel opened.
Yep.
But you spent 10 days in the yellow jersey.
Yeah, I was good in the classification because I was good in the prologue. I think I was 8th in the classification. So, but finally, to come over to the UK, we have to do a time trial with the formation GBMG. A strong team, good riders, and we are really motivated to do it good because all the riders are very close in the classification. But I saw that was the first. If we won, I take the yellow jersey.
Right.
So it was with Carlo Boumans, with Peters, me, Cassani, the national team director now of Italy. And we won. Yeah, on the podium with all the Lions because if we won as a team, every rider have a lion.
Is it a baby Lion of Flanders almost, really? Is a precursor?
Yeah, but I was not yet the Lion of Flanders.
No, the
early. Because I was not yet a classic rider. I was a sprinter yet.
Yep.
I did the transformation a little bit later when I go to Italy to Patrick Lefebvre.
Okay.
Then he was saying to me, now, okay, you don't have to do not the sprints anymore because we have Cipollini. You have to do the layout for him. Now you have to win a classic, for example, Tour of Flanders.
So how did you, that's really interesting. So 10 days in the jersey, you were a sprinter. That's what I remember you as a young guy, you're Belgian champion, winning sprints. So did you, along with Patrick, say, okay, I'm now going to train differently? Or was the engine already there? You just thought differently. How did that happen?
That was the beginning of testing and the Conconi test and training and totally different than we did before.
Yeah.
Before we did hours.
Yeah.
5 hours, 6 hours, 6 hours, 7 hours, 8 hours.
Yeah.
And that was a little bit of transformation in cycling. So yeah, then he said to me, you don't have to sprint anymore. Now you have to win a big classic. And I won that year also the Tour of Flanders and the national champion jersey.
It's a big win, especially in the Belgian jersey. That must have, I mean, all of these special moments, I mean, can you remember? I bet you can remember pretty much every detail of the back end of that race, crossing the line, winning the Ronde in the bands of Belgian champion. Must have been a very special moment, especially when you change from the sprinter. Now, Lefebvre believed in you, said you must be a classic specialist, and you delivered. That must have been very, very satisfying.
I was already one time second when I was riding to the ADR to the Lotto formation 1 year. And I was on the breakaway with Edwig van Ooydonk.
Yep. It's Roubaix.
Yeah, that's me.
Thank you.
I was on the breakaway with Edwig van Ooydonk and two guys of Ariostea, Rolf Gults and...
Wasn't it Sørensen?
Sørensen, yeah. Rolf Sørensen, yes, yeah. Thank you.
No worries.
And I was know that Edwig van Ooydonk will attack at the Bosberg, so I was close to him and I say... Oh,
Eddie Bosberg was
yeah,
his name.
Yeah, yeah, I stay in his wheel, but finally pfft, I was dropped and I was second. And that's okay, second, eh? I was happy.
I'll be happy with that.
And that day, after the race, I was getting the car with my parents and I say, one day I will win Tour de Flanders. I didn't know that I will win three times. Because now I know that's a big difference to be second and to be win Tour de Flanders.
Yeah.
If you win Tour de Flanders, especially in Belgium, and I think also in the UK, maybe it will be the same Roubaix, Flanders. It's always difficult to say.
Yeah, I mean, I've won the Merseyside Div Champs. but no.
I say, maybe I will win three times Roubaix and three times Flanders, for example. I won three times.
Actually, when you look at the... Let's take the World Championships to one side, because that was obviously special in Lugano when you won that. But which of all of the monument wins, the three Flanders wins, the three Roubaix wins, which was the sweetest of all of those victories? If you can do that. Or which meant the most to you at that time when it happened? Which
of classics? Difficult to say if you won 11 World Cup races and 150 other races.
Johan Museeuw.
But I have to say, if you come world champion, that day it's really special with that jersey and everything around. But the next year, if you can wear every day, wherever you race, that jersey, it's give you something special. I have to say, yeah, Lugano was something special for me.
I was racing the same race that day.
I
got off and watched the finish from the hotel.
It was a hard race. It was a hard circuit. It wasn't for a sprinter.
It was very hard.
So, and especially my coach was Eddie Merckx.
Okay. Okay, there we go.
I have also something to say about that. Not that it was Eddie Merckx, but 2 days before training, I pick up the bike and Eddie Merckx was near me and he said to me, if you put your saddle 2 millimeters higher, you will win. And that's a true story, yeah?
Wow.
And what you can do if Eddie Merckx say to you.
You're gonna...
So I did it and I won. And that's a true story.
Wow.
Yeah, 2 millimeters.
So what? How did he?
I lost Flanders in 2 millimeters between Bunyu.
Yeah.
But in Lugano, I won.
Because it was an unusual for a world circuit because it was very hilly, two big climbs.
Normally, a rider don't do that to make another position.
Yeah.
But I was so surprised that the mix said to me, if you put your saddle 2 millimeters higher, you will win.
Did you just say yes because it was Eddie Merckx, or did you say why?
I say to him, give me the key because I know Eddie Merckx had always, yeah, that's true, a key in his pocket.
He had the Allen key in his pocket, yeah.
In his pocket.
So there you go, do it now. 2 mil and you won the World Championships.
And that's a true story.
That's amazing.
Yeah.
That's amazing.
But I don't believe it's that 2 millimeters alone. I was in a good shape, good condition.
Yeah.
Tactical way, I did it quite good. Long breakaway with riders, Swiss guys, and they were chasing.
Yep.
I say, well, let them go. And finally, I was in the breakaway with Mauro Gianetti, also a Swiss guy.
Yep.
And yeah, he was trying to let me away. The last time that he was attacking, I was riding near him. I say, Mauro, it will be impossible.
He just, You just did that yeah. gamesmanship. You just
I was looking in his eyes. See?
Yeah.
No.
you'd just say, all right, then go on in. It's quite terrifying, actually. Wow. So did you, I mean, you clearly believed so much that you just wanted to kind of just use that kind of psychological warfare on him, just say, just to try and kind of break him mentally before you'd even done the sprint.
Yeah, yeah, but that's a physical way. A rider has to be top, and but also here. So, a rider has to be completely, and it starts from here to there.
Yeah.
So you have some riders still now that not really so clever.
Okay. Huh? We won't name any.
I don't say names, but tactical way, now you see some things that you say, oh, that's not so okay.
And when you obviously had this unwavering sense of belief in that you were going to win, and you won, but to cross the line, I mean, and realize you'd done it, with all the other victories already amassed over your career, that must have been a powerfully emotional moment for you.
Lugano?
Yeah.
It was unexpected because the circuit was very hard, and then
it was like an Ardennes circuit, really, wasn't it? When you think about
yeah.
it, more than a Flandrian circuit.
It was a hard race, but I know one day I can do it. That's what I say. Mm. 10 days, I was okay, but more than 10 days, I was not okay. But the world is just one day.
Yeah,
it's a 1 day race, like a classic race, like Roubaix and Flanders and all the other races. And yeah, I was better in 1 day than 3 weeks.
Yeah, and that's where your strength lay, wasn't it? That was.
So that's the reason that I didn't was a Grand Tour racer. I won 2 stages and 2-time time trial.
Yeah.
So I won totally 4 times.
Right. Yeah. 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 2 team time trials.
And I have 10 days yellow jersey.
Where are those yellow jerseys?
In Belgium we have a lot of museums. And they are there, one at home, one jersey with my parents, and one jersey with my young boy.
Okay.
Because my young boy is also very patient in cycling, and next year he will coming professional in a new development team of Patrick Lefebvre.
Fantastic.
So history is coming again.
We're going to see another.
Before last year he was cyclocrossman. This year he was trying on the road with the results, and next year he's professional.
That's exciting.
Stranger.
That's
totally the same way that I did.
Yeah, but it must make you very proud to see. I've watched your son grow up in the last few years and see him progressing to the development ranks under the tutelage of Patrick. I mean, that must make you very proud.
You know, I still have the passion of cycling. I still bike a lot, and I still watching television with the riders, the new generation, and I love the new generation. I love now the new cycling because it's totally different than old generation.
Yeah.
But I have a lot of respect of this generation now because they make it more like, sorry, sex and rock and roll.
Yeah?
Yeah.
I know what you mean.
Yeah?
Yeah.
And that's what cycling needs.
Yeah. You need to see people having fun, don't you?
Yeah. Young people have to watch television or have to watch Sagan, for example.
Yeah.
Then they see, yes.
You need characters to be flamboyant. And
it's totally different now. The image is also important. For us, the most important thing was to win.
Yeah.
The image was not so important.
Yeah, yeah. Okay, well, we're going to have to end it now. It's gone so quickly. Well, I tell you what we'll do, because I'm a little bit frightened right now. I'm going to get beaten up. What we'll do, we're going to take one question from the audience. It's Johan Museeuw. So first person to raise their hand with a decent question, we'll get it answered, and then we'll move on to our next guest. So come on, guys. There you go. And your name is, mate?
Jack.
Jack. Mate, Johan Museeuw.
Of this generation. Our generations, we have some guys who can win Tour de France, Roubaix, and all the other races. Now we have more riders. The peloton is also bigger, and everybody on the start is in a good shape, good preparation, good test, power meters, everything, good teams, a lot of money. And now the level of the riders is much better in totally than in our generation. So it's quite difficult to say now who is now the best classic rider. I have to say Sagan. But for the moment, he won just one time Flanders. And he didn't won yet Milano-San Remo.
There you go.
Yeah. If you say maybe 8 years before, Sagan will win a couple times Milan-San Remo and a couple times Tour de Flanders, I will say yes, of course, yes.
He's yet to deliver, isn't he? Yeah. Three world championships.
And
though, but,
it's quite difficult to win Flanders because I have speak about Eddy Merckx. He won just two times Tour de Flanders. And he won all the rest of the races more than five, six, eight, nine times.
Yes, seven times Milan-San Remo. Yeah. Ridiculous, yeah. Well, thanks very much for your question, Jack. We are going to have to wrap it up now, and next time we need to do an hour, I think. But
yeah,
it's been an
it was also very silent, and thank you very much to be so silent and to listen.
Very respectful audience. Johan Museeuw. Well, we've got a couple more guests. Next up, I'll be in conversation with Mark Cavendish and Adam Blythe, talking about Mark's top six wins. And then we'll round off with a gentleman called Kenny Van Vlamink. So two more. He's not turned up yet. So please take a couple of minutes to reset, and we'll be back on stage in just a few minutes with Mr. Mark Cavendish. I cannot wait. Thanks very much, guys. Cheers. We'll be right back.